Hey guys, good evening. Just put a quick VIC in the chat box if you can hear me loud and clear. Yeah, is the voice audible? Okay, great. So yeah, how are you all doing, guys? Everything good? Everything good? Yeah. VIC. Hectic. Devjana is saying hectic. Hi, Jigna. Hi. Yes. Okay. Sachin is rocking. That's great. We should take inspiration from Sachin, I guess. Yeah. Chalo. So let's begin with the session then. I hope you guys remember what we did in the last week. Yeah. Did anyone practice it up? Obulesh is saying not able to progress the practice. Obulesh, you need to start it up now, right? Sagar is saying no practice. Why? Why is it so? Sagar, Obulesh? No time? Obulesh is saying not able to install NumPy and Flask. Why is it so? Did you send any other screenshot to academics? Avinash is saying too busy with work. Okay, understand. Okay, Sachin is saying, I guess requirements.txt is not uploaded over there because Jigna was reminding me several times, but it just got slipped out of my mind. Sorry for that. What I'll do is I'll upload that requirements.txt along with the materials that I'll be uploading tomorrow. So you'll get it. That's not going to be an issue. And Obulesh is saying they said to install, but I could not do in VM and GCP server. Obulesh, just describe the issue that you are facing to academics and I guess we'll clear it up over there. Yeah, I understand, Vikash. Anyways, we are left with, I guess, including today, we are left with three more sessions. So after that, your Tuesday that is blocked for this series will be free. You will be free to work on Tuesdays. But yeah, I understand because of this series, you guys have blocked your Tuesdays from a very long time now. Yeah. Sure, Jigna, we'll plan something more as well. Let's see. Because this was a very long, what you can say, it's a very long series, right? So I'll also take some rest in between now because my also Tuesdays are getting blocked every time. Chalo. So anyways, obviously we'll plan something good. Yeah. And let's see what we can do. So what I was asking is how many of you tried it out? Did anyone try it out in GCP? Deployed that thing in GCP, or if not in GCP, in localhost itself, did anyone do it? Obulesh said he tried in GCP, but you were not successful on that, I guess, right? Obulesh? Sachin is saying I tried. Is your okay? Great. Dheeraj tried in local server. So Dheeraj, the outcome was there, or you were also facing some kind of error or something? Ankesh, great. We would love to see that, huh? And not this one. I hope you will create some great web apps going ahead. Yeah, whatever project you are doing, what you can do, since you have learned this thing now, what you can do, you can just deploy it up and put the link over there whenever you are submitting those projects. Yeah, that is anyways going to be beneficial for you. I tried creating the web app using Streamlit and need to deploy it using. Okay. Yeah, you can use Streamlit as well. Yeah. Try deploy it using AWS or GCP or any cloud service provider. That's not an issue. Yeah. Chalo, that's great. So if you guys remember, there was an issue that we faced in the end when I gave you guys the link over here, the public link of the web app. You faced an issue. What was that issue? Is anyone of you remember that? Yeah. Is there anyone who remembers what was the issue over there where that we faced in the last week? In the very end, it was not working since it is... No, it was not local, Sagar. We deployed it in server. I guess you missed 1 week in between. We deployed it in server and we made it public, right? The page was loaded for some and not for someone. Yeah, true. It crashed basically. So the model that the web app that we created was obviously deployed on server. We did GUnicorn, but still it crashed because the model was not scaled at that particular extent, right? The model was not scaled. So now our work is to scale the model. before scaling, so for that, obviously, we'll be using a tool known as Kubernetes. Yeah, we'll be using that. But before going ahead with Kubernetes, you'll have to containerize the whole web app that we have created, the work that we have done till date. You'll have to containerize it. Is the voice audible now? Is the voice audible? Just put a quick VIC if the voice is audible. VIC? Okay. Sorry. I don't know. The internet just disconnected. So what I was saying is, how many of you have heard the term Docker? Yeah, we'll be using Docker, Pratik. How many of you have heard the term Docker? I guess the ones who are working in the developer or in the DevOps side, they might have heard it, right? Yeah. No issues on that, Manish. We'll look into it, Jigna. The today's session is only on Docker. We won't be touching Kubernetes today. It's only for containerization and Docker. So fine, leave Docker. How many of you have heard about virtual machines? I hope this term is heard by each and everyone, right? Virtual machines, VM. Yeah, most of you have heard it, right? So what is a virtual machine, by the way? Any brief description, anything? Yeah, Milesh, I know it's VM, the short form is VM. What I'm asking is, what is virtual machine? Yeah, any brief idea about virtual machine? If actually hardware, great, Prashant, cloud-based computing. Yeah, you can say that. Virtual box, partitioning, cloud. Okay, not real. So most honest answer is from Kaushik. He's just saying that it's not real, it's virtual. great sense of humor. Yep, great. Okay, so we'll start with that. For that, I'll be using an article. Before moving ahead with that, one more thing that I want to announce here today is, what we have done is we have started creating articles on this whole series, right? The series from, so what was the first step that we did in the whole series? The first session, if anyone remember, we did data abstraction, right? SQL and MongoDB, correct. So from data abstraction till the last session, that is going to be on CI/CD, that is continuous integration and deployment, that is going to be covered in articles. We have created articles for you guys, because as far as I can see, you guys need to understand one thing. The stuff that we are doing nowadays, from I guess past 2-3 sessions, we were dealing all those stuffs in command prompt and our shell and all those stuffs, right? We didn't use any Jupyter notebook kind of thing. Yeah, correct. Yes. So that can't be saved and can't be uploaded over there on LMS. So what I did was, I thought that to help you guys out, we should create articles with screenshots of the same, with all those commands that we have used, so that you guys can cope up with the same. Yeah, getting my point? So we have created articles for you guys on Medium. We haven't published it yet. It's still on process. I guess it will be done by tomorrow or day after tomorrow, most probably. So once it is done, I'll upload all those articles in each and every step. We have created it stepwise, so I'll just give you a glimpse of it for the Docker one. Is the screen visible? Is the screen visible, guys? This chat box thing is not working again. Is it visible now? Is it visible? Is the screen visible? Yes. Okay, great. So this is how we have created those articles. Basically, today's session is on containerization. That's why I'm showing it, this article, to you guys. We haven't published it yet, so you won't find it if you start searching it in Medium. We'll be doing it in a day or two, but this is how we have created it. Yeah, everything is there step by step. code and everything, how you need to do it, how, where you'll find those files and everything with the screenshots as well. Yeah. Is it going to be helpful for you guys? Yeah. Fine. So like this, we have created for each and every step. So I'll make sure that it gets uploaded by in a day or two. And then you guys can basically, I guess it will help you guys in some extent to practice it out. Yeah. Chalo, that's great. So today we'll be using this particular article inside. Basically, we don't use any article, but this article I found very helpful to explain you guys. So we'll be using this article for today for explaining virtual machine and virtual machine and containerization and Docker. Okay, I'll just paste it over here. I have pasted it in the chat. You can go through it. Yeah. So what is a virtual machine? The concept of virtual machine is very simple. Basically, what happens in virtual machine is, if I am having my laptop out here, and suppose my laptop is having Windows installed. Now, if I want to use Ubuntu over it, yeah, using the same laptop, I want to use it Ubuntu over it. One thing I can do is I can dual boot my system. I can dual boot it. And the other option is I can create a virtual machine of that, and I can use Ubuntu in my Windows system. Are you able to understand what I am saying? Either you can double boot. I hope you guys know what is double boot. Basically, in one single system, you are having both Ubuntu and Windows. Yeah, two OS in one single system. So once you start your laptop, you'll get an option to select whether you want to boot with Ubuntu, whether you want to boot with Windows. This is what double boot does. But what happens in virtual machine, you don't get the option for double boot. You will get into your Windows system and then you'll start a virtual machine. But what is happening in that particular virtual machine? Your physical resources are being used. Yeah, your physical resources are being used. So basically, if you are having, suppose, a 16 GB system. Yeah, if you are having a 16 GB system and you have created a 8 GB is virtual machine having 8 GB of RAM, then this 16 GB is going to be splitted into two. That is one 8 GB for your virtual and 8 GB will be available for your own work in your base machine. Are you able to understand what I am saying? This is how virtual machine. Yeah, you can allocate RAM as per your need. That's what I'm saying. I allocated 8 GB. You can allocate 4 GB as well. You can allocate 2 GB as well. It's up to you. But any amount of RAM you are allocating, it's going to be allocated from the total amount of RAM that you are having. Here in my case, I am saying I am having 16 GB of RAM. So if I am creating a virtual machine of 4 GB, then that 4 GB will be deducted from my base machine. Clear? Okay. Now, let's have a look at this image. I have already opened it up. Yeah, you can allocate it as per your need. That's what I'm saying, Pratik. You can allocate it as per your need. But that, suppose you are doing 8 GB, 4 GB, 200 GB of hard disk, that much amount of memory is being occupied in your local system. That's what I'm saying. Yeah. Is this image visible to you? Yeah. So here, let's start with virtual machine. So basically, this is the architecture of a virtual machine. Here, what is happening? You'll be having your infrastructure. And by infrastructure, I mean all those specifications that you are having. Yeah. Then you'll have your host operating system. You'll have your host operating system. Getting my point? Then you'll have something known as hypervisor. What is Indra? I didn't get it. What is Indra? Infrastructure. That's what I'm saying, Umesh, that all those specifications in your system. Yeah. Then you'd be having something known as hypervisor. And above these three layers, you'll be having your apps. Okay. By apps, all those apps that we have created till date. Yeah. But for those apps, there is one more layer that is added, which is guest operating system. Every app is having guest operating system. Okay. And after guest operating system, you'll be having the libraries, the dependencies, and the app at the topmost layer. This is how virtual machine works. So basically, in virtual machine, you'll have to take care of your host operating system. Suppose your host operating system is your Windows machine, and there might be several other guest OS. And those guest OS is going to have different kind of dependency versions. Yeah. Suppose this is Ubuntu. Ubuntu might support this particular dependency. And if this is going to be your Mac, it might not support. Yeah. So this is how in VM the architecture is going to happen. But what happens in containers? What happens in containers is infrastructure will be there, obviously. There will be your host operating system. Then in top of that, you'll be having your Docker engine. And here, what is the difference? Come on. Can anyone tell me difference between these two? No guest OS. And guest OS is something which is going to make it very, very complicated. As I said, there will be some version conflict. There will be some dependency missing, alternate dependency. You need to search for it. All these things come up. Yeah. And your resources are also saved, because obviously an OS occupies a hell lot of resources. Yeah. If you are putting two OS in one single system, it occupies a hell lot of resources, right? So here, containerization just removes these parts. Yeah. You don't need to have different guest OSs for each and everyone. It will work in your host operating system. Yeah. So this is how container and virtual machine differs. As Rahul also said, the installation is going to be very quick. If you want to change a container, you just need to, if you want to modify it something, it's going to be very easy. That is how bins and libraries are the libraries, the dependencies like NumPy, pandas, and everything for you. Yeah. So this is how virtual machine and containers differ. And Docker is a type of container. Yeah. Docker is a type of container. So what is Docker? Docker is an open source project. It's an open source, by the way, and that offers a software development solution known as containers. Yeah. To understand Docker, you need to know what containers are. I explained how containers work, basically the architectural difference of virtual machines and container. According to Docker, a container is a lightweight standalone executable package. Basically, it, whenever you are dealing with Docker, as we'll be looking at it, it converts these containers into something known as images. These are known as Docker images. Yeah. It converts itself into some Docker images, which you can easily run it. So Sohoni is saying, so which machines run faster? Containers, obviously containers, Sohoni, yeah? And since containers are platform independent, what do you mean by platform independent? Can you tell me? In this case, how containers are platform independent? No guest OS, right? It's not dependent on that particular guest OS. It can run on any OS. Yeah. So that is how Docker is going to be beneficial. Docker can run across both Windows and Linux based platforms. In fact, Docker can also be run with a virtual machine if need be. The main purpose of Docker is that it lets you run microservice applications in a distributed architecture. Basically, they are referring it to Kubernetes and all those stuff. Can we have Windows OS using containers? Can we have Linux? Yeah, you can have it, Sagar. Yep. iOS is a phone. It's a mobile operating system, Nirvan. And obviously, in behind iOS also, Docker containers are running, right? That's why you are able to execute our apps and everything. So this is what Docker is. No, that see, Vishal, that's what we are saying. It's platform independent. You can use it in any operating system. So this is what Docker is. We'll just look at the advantages of Dockers and advantages of virtual machines. Yeah. So what is happening here is the tools associated with the virtual machines are easier to access and simpler to work with. Obviously, the tools are present over there in a local system, so it's gonna be a bit easier to access, right? It gets difficult to access the resources over there in cloud, but it's very easier over here. Architecture, that's what I showed you, right? This is the architecture. This is architecture, Umesh. Architecture of containers and architecture of virtual machines. Every web app that is being done, if you see Flipkart and everything in backend, Docker is running. Yeah, Parimal. Nowadays, everyone is using Dockers. So, as I said, in virtual machines, the resources are easy to access. As mentioned earlier, once you have a virtual machine up and running, you can start a Docker instance within that VM. As I said, you can create Dockers in VM as well, because VM is also nothing but your own server kind of thing, right? It's also a computer over there. So you obviously you can start a Docker instance over here. Now let's see the advantages of Docker. What is the advantage? First advantage is Docker containers are process isolated and don't require a hardware hypervisor. As we saw in the what you say in the architecture, which error you were saying, Santosh? We haven't yet reached till installation part. So we are not using Docker desktop here, Vishal. We will see which what you we are doing. Please wait till we are reaching the installation part. Yeah. So Docker is fast, as I said, it's very fast. Containers can be shared across multiple team members, so it's very easy to share those Docker images. As I said, you'll get an image over there which you can share it easily. Yeah. So this is what Docker and VM machine basically how it differs. Yeah, so these are some of the commands that we guys will be using, like Docker build to build the image, Docker pull to pull the image, and to run the image. So what will happen once you give these command, it will go to something known as Docker daemon. What is Docker daemon? It's explained over here. A background process responsible for receiving commands and passing them to the containers via command line. So we'll be using command line interface for that, and we'll see how we'll be accessing these things. Yep. So one more thing that I would like to add is what happens is whenever you are not suppose you are creating a web app that we did, right? We had different phases, like we had the database thing, we have our Flask app, we'll be having the what you can say the JUnicorn and all those stuff. So these can be plugged in. This can be pulled it into one container. That makes it very easy to change if you want to change something without hampering each and every other thing. Yeah, that is how Docker becomes helpful. So now we'll see how to practically implement Docker, how to containerize the stuff that we have done till date. Are you guys ready to experience that now? Yeah, so for that, what should be the first thing that I should do? I should access my server. Yeah. For that, I'll have to open which one? I'll have to open my Bitwise. Let me just share the screen now. Is the screen visible now? So this is how we'll be we use our Bitwise. If you remember what we used to do, we used to provide our host IP and then we used to click on login. Yes, except for this session. and then I'll have to put in my password. Obviously, I can't tell you the password. So authentication completed. This is Putty. This is a version of Putty. Sadhubey. This is the version of Putty. Bitwise, you can. I gave you the link, I guess, in the previous session. It is a type. It is basically from Putty itself. Let me see. Download Bitwise. This is the link that I am putting. Okay, already these guys have put it. Great. Yeah, I have also already provided the link in LMS as well. Yeah, you can check that out. So I have logged into my server now. So what should I do next? I should open my console, right? Are you able to see the command line prompt now? Is the command line interface visible? No. Why is this screen sharing thing getting very difficult today? Is it visible now? Yeah, perfectly visible. Great. Fine. So we are into our Ubuntu server that we were working in the last session. Yeah. So here, let's see what is present. Our churn is present over here, which we created in the last session. You remember everything that we did in the last session, I hope, right? If not, you can refer the recording. And also, what I would say is, if you guys feel like, if you want to explore those recordings like instantly, if you want to see, we have uploaded those recordings in YouTube as well. So once you go to the YouTube channel of ours, you'll find a separate playlist for that. Yes. So this is the playlist. So you can access those videos easily over here. We uploaded it in, I guess, a day or two before, on March 4th we did it. Yeah. So I have pasted the link over there in the chat box. So you can go through that. And also in the YouTube itself, we have all those ad hoc sessions that I used to take, like on Streamly, Teapot, Task. Whosoever have not attended it, you guys can go through these sessions. These are also going to be useful, right? These are some of those latest tools that is being utilized in the industry right now. Like Rapids is something which is being used by NVIDIA. Dask is over there. Teapot is an AutoML tool. PyCarrot is an AutoML tool. We did deployment using Streamlit as well. So you guys can go through those playlists. It's over there in the channel. Yeah. So yeah, this is our churn. Now what I need to do, I need to change the directory to churn. Yep. Done. Now let's see what is present over there. Our app.py is present, our randomforest.pkl is present, our requirements.txt is present, static is present, and templates is present. Yeah. Now, what I need to do, let's see, we'll open the app.py first. Vmap.py. I hope you remember this thing. Yep. Okay, so we'll exit this now. Fine. So what I need to do now is, I'll have to rename this app.py to something else. Can anyone tell me why I need to do this? Can anyone tell me why I need to rename my app.py to some other name? I can't see two app.py. why I need to do is, if you open it up, the app name here I have defined as app. Name of the app is app, and I have defined that file, the script name, as app.py, which gets conflicting whenever we are going ahead. That's why it's better to rename it up, or otherwise you can just change the name whenever you are uploading it up. But here I'll have to do it through command line because it's uploaded it in the server. So for that, we'll have this command mv, what is the name, app.py, and I'll change it to flask app.py. Okay, the name is changed. If I check ls now, I am getting it as flask app.py. randomforest.pkl is the pickle model that we saved. requirements.txt, we created it in the last session. Static and templates are for the photos. Clear till here? Yeah, MV is for move. It's for move, or you can say for rename. Yep. Is there anyone who is having any confusion out here? Yes, I can't see any replies out here. What's up, guys? Getting confused or something? Yeah. Okay, good. Now we will start with the Docker installation. Okay, for that I'll have to first of all update my apt. Sudo apt get update. For that, yeah, sure, Siddharth, no worries, you can do that. Inside that, fine. So we have updated our this apt-get, and now we need to install Docker. So for that we have the command, that is sudo. Yeah, that you will learn once you start working on Ubuntu. Now you'll get to learn it. It's very easy, but you'll have to practice it up. Obviously, you, these are some of these things which you don't need to memorize. Never try to memorize commands in Ubuntu. Yeah, otherwise I hope the guys who works in Ubuntu, they know. If you start memorizing Ubuntu commands, then it's like going to be a very big mess up in your head. Yeah. So we'll install Docker now. Docker.io. So in my case, it's already installed, so I don't need to install it again. But yeah, I just showed it up to you. You can check that out, Santosh. If you want to install Docker in Windows 10, you can check the documentation out here. Here we are dealing with Ubuntu, and I would suggest always, whenever you are dealing with some production kind of thing, always go for Ubuntu. Never go for Windows. You will be facing lots and lots of issues out there if you are going to use Windows, because Windows is something which is very secure, and you won't be getting authorization for something, this, that, and lots of headache will come. So whenever you are dealing with these kind of production kind of thing, always go for Ubuntu. Yeah, I am doing it in GCP server, the same server that we are dealing with in the last session, Ovilesh. Yeah, CentOS is also a version of Linux, right? So that's cool, you can use it. So Docker is installed. Now let's see which version of Docker is installed. For that, Docker dash dash version. So Docker version 19.03.8 is installed. No, you'll have to explicitly install it up, Simil. Docker is something which is not going to be used in your script. It's going to containerize, right? It's not a library. Yep, only libraries that are going to be used over there in your this thing, in your what you can say, in your script, that needs to be put in the requirements.txt. Yeah. So our Docker is installed. We have checked the Docker version. Let me just clear the screen once. I'll just show you the Docker version again if you haven't seen it. Yeah, Docker version 19.0.3.8. Is it visible, guys? Is it visible? Yeah. Okay, great. Now we will enable our Docker. It's installed but not yet enabled. So for that we have a command that is sudo systemctl enable Docker. Okay, my Docker is enabled. For that, if you want to check the status of Docker, there is a command. You'll just have to replace enable with status. See, it's written here active running. Is it visible, guys? So my Docker is running now, but I haven't created any image yet. I haven't containerized it yet. Yeah, we have just enabled our Docker. You need to enable it whenever you are starting it up. Yeah. So once you enable it, now you'll have to start your Docker. Once you enable it, you need to start your Docker. So here I'll put Control C. Now I'll have to start my Docker. For that, the command is, in place of status, you'll have to put start Docker. Now my Docker is started. Now you'll have to create a socket out there to, if I show you this part, to get this particular connection over here with the daemon, okay, with the Docker daemon. There is a command. Yeah, Ankesh, you can carry on with that, no problem. Yeah, we'll see you in the next session. So for that, we'll have to put a command to connect it with the socket. So we'll be using sudo chmod 666. This is a generalized command that you need to do. Yeah. So once you do this, you have connected it up. Yeah. See, systemctl stands for system control. So these are some by default commands. So I also don't know what is the work of it, right? But yeah. So now we have connected it up. Now we'll have to start containerizing it. For that, we'll have to create some layers. Yes, 666 is access. So for that, we'll have to create some layers. For that, I'll have to create a Docker file in the directory that is going to be Docker file. Okay. That we will be doing ovulation, but not in this session. In the model monitoring, we'll be doing a monitoring session. Once we are deploying it in Kubernetes, then I'll show it to how these things are how these particular things are working in GCP server. Yeah. Now I'll have to create a Docker file. Yeah. So for that, I'll have to create layer by layer. So we'll start with first layer that is going to be my from. We'll start with the very first thing that is Python. We'll have to start with Python. We are using Python 3.8. Yeah, Python version, I have specified it. Now the second thing that I need to do is I'll have to get my requirement.txt. Requirements.txt. This is how you create a Docker file. Slash. Then the second thing is going to be, I have to create my directory and I'll have to copy my app over there. this should be in small letter. The name is in small, yeah. Work directory I'll have to create. Slash app. You'll get all these things over there in the article, so you don't need to fear it up now. Yeah, I'm exposing my port number 8000 over here. And in the last, I'll have to deploy it using GUnicorn. For that, I'll use my GUnicorn command that we did in the last session. GUnicorn flask app colon app dash dash bind. We give the open our this thing, open IP and the port number. Our port number is how much? 8000. So we have copied Python 3.8, we have copied requirements.txt. Work directory we created, we exposed 8000. We did the last thing, that is exposed it into GUnicorn. In GUnicorn is still left. We'll have to mention the workers and the threads as well. We'll do it here. Threads equals to 3. Yep. Now we need to also put one more thing, I guess. What does GUnicorn does, Rupesh? I guess someone from the students will be able to explain it up. We did it in the last session. Is there anyone who want to volunteer for that? Can anyone explain, Rupesh, what is GUnicorn? We did it in the last session, I guess, right? Basically, GUnicorn helps in getting more number of requests at a time. Manish wants to do it. Okay, great. I'll unmute Manish over here. Where is Manish? Manish, you can unmute yourself.
Good evening, Hemanka. You can hear me?
Yeah, we can hear you perfectly. Okay. Hi.
Great. Yeah. Great. Hello. So where we use GUnicorn is basically when there's multi-threading, like if there are too many users which are using the same this thing, so then we need to install GUnicorn. Yeah. For that, first we create the WSGI using that nano WSGI.py, and then from app import we do those commands and then we can get into that. And what GUnicorn basically does, it will tell you that if suppose there are number of workers are 5, so it will tell you that the specific command, so how you can the worker for that you have a formula also, like number of cores into 2 plus 1.
Exactly, correct.
Number of workers we can have in
basically this is how GUnicorn works. Yeah, so what you can do is Rupesh, you can go through that recording. You can see how we implemented GUnicorn. But basically, Manish gave you an overview of what GUnicorn does. Yeah, great one, Manish. Good one.
Thank
good
you.
One.
Thanks.
Yeah. Fine. So we actually left one more thing, I guess. There was a command to run because we haven't installed the requirements.txt yet, right? We just copied it up. So we'll have to do that. We'll have to install it. Pip3 install dash r requirements.txt. Done. So this is our Docker file. We created the Docker file here. So now we'll save it. How to save it? Escape. Colon. Oh, just a second, my chat will open. Escape colon WQ and we save it. Okay. W and exclamation mark. Yeah. let's have a look at ls now. See, the Docker file is present over there. Is it visible, guys? So we have created our Docker file. Now we need to execute it up. So for that, we'll build it first. We'll build a Docker image. For that, we have the command Docker build. If you remember this thing, this one, Docker build. So we'll do Docker build over here and will provide us the app name. That is basically, this is a tag that we are giving to that image. You can put it anything. I will put it as I missed a dash T. Then I'll put it as Flask app. Let's keep it as Flask app. Yeah. So once I press enter, so Docker is now built. Now we'll have to look at the image. Docker images. Image is not created. Okay. So it's not built, I guess. Is there anything over there? Docker build T Flask app. Okay. I missed that dot. We don't need to put over here. We need to put a dot here. Yeah. See, it's building it up. It will take some time over here to build that image. And then we'll see how that image is being saved over here. So it will take a few seconds for the very first time. But once you are done with the very first time, and if you want to update it up, that's going to be very easy. Yeah. Step two, it is copying the requirements.txt. It is basically, see, it's happening layer by layer, right? Are you able to understand how it's happening? It's doing layer by layer. First thing it did was you got the Python 3.8. Now it's copying the requirements.txt. Then it will install that up. Yes, guys, are you able to understand? Can I have a heads up over here? Yeah, great. Every library is getting installed now. Then we'll look at the images. Basically, this is going to be one image that we are creating. Have to clear the screen. I guess it's lots and lots of mess now. It's copying the app. It's exposed. Yeah, great. Now we look at the images, Docker images. See, a new image Flask app has been created 9 seconds ago, and the size of that image is 1.23 GB. And this is going to be your image ID. Are you able to see that, guys? I'll just clear the screen and let you, I guess then it will be visible. Docker images. Yep. So our image is created. Now we are left with the last step, that is to run the container. That is Docker run -d, that's it. Just rm p, and I'll have to map it into some other port. So in my server, I have opened my 8050 port as well. So I'm mapping it into my 8050 port. Yep. Then I'll have to give my tag name, that is Flask app here. This is my tag. Yeah. Once I press enter, my Docker image is being executed. Now we'll have to check it if the app is running or not. For that, what I need to do, I need to put my IP, yes, and colon 8050. it's getting opened. So we have executed this web app using Docker this time. I'll paste the link now over here. You guys can try that out and see, because there will be an issue now. It's just so try everyone, just keep on executing it. Some or the other will face issue over here. It's working great. Since we have used GUnicorn, it might most of you might be able to use it, but still great. So if I put Docker ps-a, so this container is getting executed, not working. Yeah, so this container is getting executed over here. So if you press Docker PSA, you'll get the active container. So yeah, that's what I'm saying. It's gonna take time. Can anyone tell me why is it taking time? Can anyone tell me? If you remember the very first people, okay, the very first students like Rashe, Sukrut, Vishal, Samta, Dheeraj, it was working from them, for them. But once everyone started putting it up over there, it started getting stopped. It started getting stuck. Exactly, Pratik. Pratik, put it over in the all panelists and attendees. We need to scale it up. Yeah. And for that, what we need to do? So we will do Docker PS will just give it. We'll show you the active containers over there. Here we are, only one container is active. So that particular container is being shown over here. Yes? Exactly. Docker Swarm is there, Docker orchestration. Yeah? These kind of things needs to be done to scale it up. So that particular thing we are going to cover in the next session. So next session is going to be your session on Kubernetes. For that, we'll be using something known as Google Kubernetes Engine. Yeah, that we'll be using. It's already present over there in the what you can say. It's already there. It's there in AWS as well. I'm not remembering the name of that, but yeah, it's there. Jignai saying on observation every time why it is not predicting, not churn. What was the accuracy? Just think about it, Jigna. I want this answer from you. Why it's predicting, not churn. Actually, you are the one who just picked it up. That's great. But I want the answer from you. Why it is predicting, not churn. Why it's not predicting churn. Go through the .ipynb file once that we created on model building. Yeah. I'm expecting this answer from you in the next session or by any tomorrow. Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Just have a look at it, why it's not doing that. No, we have done containerization. We have just wrapped it up, Sagar. We have wrapped it in the container, but we haven't scaled it up yet. We need to scale it using Kubernetes. For that, we have Kubernetes, yeah? That's what I'm saying, Jugna. You can just go through that ipynb file once. You'll get to understand, I'm sure about it. Go through the model evaluation part, yeah? And you'll understand, I'm sure about it. Yeah, this container can be moved to any other system. For that, you'll get to know, because in while we'll be going for Kubernetes, you'll get to understand. Yeah, you'll see how we'll be moving from one server to other and everything we'll see. Okay, fine. So that's all for today's session, guys. You guys can carry on. I hope the Docker part was understood. I mean, it was obviously it's a bit complicated, but still, yeah. Anyways, put the I'll just put this thing or the articles over there by tomorrow or day after tomorrow, and then it will be a bit easier for you. Yeah, okay, chalo. Thank you, Rahul. You guys can carry on. I guess it's already 9. So we are done for the day. We will meet tomorrow next week, same time. Yeah. Okay. Thank you. Bye-bye. Good night. Yes. Good night.